everyone. My name is Gabrielle, and we're here with Dr. Lori Morimoto to discuss a presentation on anime in America from analog to digital. She'll present for a little bit, and then if you have any questions, feel free to leave a comment, and I'll monitor them, and we can see if she has any answers for you. So take it away, Lori.
All right. Hi, everyone. I'm going to share a presentation with you as soon as I figure out how I'm doing that. Give me just 1 second. This is the first time I've ever done this on this platform, so I don't know how to share it.
Yeah, so on the bottom of your screen, do you have a share button, a share screen button?
Yeah, it's like in the place.
I do see it down here. Let me add it.
Yep, okay.
There you go.
Okay.
Sorry.
I need both of those added if possible.
Yep. All right. I'll do both.
Sorry about that.
Nope. You're fine. Oh. I'll add the video when you're ready to show the video.
Okay, that sounds good.
And add that back to the stream. And there you go.
All right. Great. Thanks.
You're welcome.
To here. All right, so I am ostensibly talking about anime in America from analog to digital, but I think a lot of what I'm talking about today, is relevant sort of across the board in terms of media fandoms. The subtitle for this, instead of from analog to digital, could be something like, how did we get here? And if you've ever spent any time in online fandoms, you know that right now, especially on social media, Twitter, Tumblr, places like that, it can be a bit of a, I don't want to say cesspool, but it can be a little bit dicey sometimes interacting with others. And so one of the things I'd like to do today is just talk about sort of how we got to this point, what's behind that, and so that we understand it a little bit better. And I think anime is actually a really good sort of medium through which to talk about that. So to start with, I wanted to just introduce some of the early anime in America for those of you who may not be familiar with it. Anime in America originally arrived on the heels of Osamu Tezuka's work, and in particular, Astro Boy, or as he was called in the US, Atom Boy. This was actually a series that, it was in black and white, it was a series that was syndicated by NBC, who had signed a contract for a certain number of episodes. It was massaged for the American market. Certain things that happen in Astro Boy don't happen in Atom Boy. But for the most part, it was as was seen in Japan, only dubbed into English. Another 1960s anime that I happened to watch just because I lived in Hong Kong as a child, and we got kind of more esoteric, I guess, unusual anime that had also made it to the US was Undersea Boy Marine, or as we call him, Marine Boy. He has a song. It's Marine Boy, and anyway, you don't need to hear the song. This aired in the United States in 1966, and it was a syndicated show, which meant that it was open to buyers. So if you had, for example, a local channel that needed some afternoon programming, this would be the kind of program they might pick up. And then the other really well-known one that came to the United States was Speed Racer. This came in 1967. It aired through 1968 in its first run, and it was also syndicated. So there's not a lot here to work with. And pretty much what you saw was what you got. Later on into the 1970s, things began to change a little bit. And a lot of this was actually on the heels of Star Wars. Now, space anime had been popular for a period before the first Star Wars movie, which is now the fourth Star Wars movie. So we'll just call it Star Wars, 1977. And the show that got picked up for release in the United States was in English called Battle of the Planets. And it aired here in its first run from 1978 to 1980. And it was adapted from the 1972 anime Science Ninja Team Gatchaman. And as I said, it capitalized on the popularity of space stories in a post-Star Wars world. So this is sort of 1977 on. And it did a few things that were sort of interesting and kind of different and not entirely popular. One is that it added an original US animated character, Seven Zark Seven, who we'll see in a minute. This was animated in the US. So the rest of the show animated in Japan, the sort of bookends with Seven Zark Seven at the beginning and the end were animated in the US, and they were specifically for an American market. And so what the distributors were trying to do basically was sort of Americanize anime, make it more culturally familiar. And the other thing that they did to ensure this was they turned what was essentially a serialized story where every week picked up from the net, from the previous one, which picked up from the previous one. When we think of serials, we think of, you know, soap operas. We think of things like, I don't know, The Sopranos. Serialized stories, just they are continuing stories. Every week you get another installment in one large story. That was how Science Ninja Team Gatchaman was originally produced. In the United States, in 1978, we really didn't have any experience of serialized animation, and we didn't really have experience of animation where stuff happened, like people died, which was in fact one of the big early draws of anime, that things happened, that you could be a teenager and watch it and not feel like an idiot. You know, it wasn't, Wonder Twins or something like that. This was, if not for adults, it was certainly for a more mature audience. And so I wanted to give you a sense of the differences between what a Japanese audience saw and what an American audience saw. And so for this, I will be using the video clip.
All right, I'll add the video to the stream now.
Okay, great.
I think it'll automatically start. Is that okay?
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay.
I'm gonna pause it for just 1 second. I just wanted to say the first sequence is from the Japanese version. It's got subtitles. And then it'll go to the second sequence. Just pay attention, you know, because it's really interesting. Pay attention to how it changes, because, yeah, it's just very interesting.
Lumina! Julia! 早くここから脱出してください! 僕たちはもういいんです。
さようなら。サイボーグとしてギャラクタに使えるよりも、人間として死ぬ方が幸福です。
私たちの死が、二人の祖国の平和の礎になるでしょう。バカな!もうそれ以上近づくな。あなた方二人は米国とアメリア国にとって大切なお方ではありませんか。分かっています。だが、私とジュリアの体は元には戻らないんです。ギャラクターは私たちをコントロールし、米国とアメリア国民をギャラクターの忠実な手先とした上、両国の地下資源を略奪しようと計画したんです。さあ、早くしないと。
もう遅いのです。私たちの体には一滴の血も流れていないのです。心臓の代わりに。
小型のミサイルが埋め込まれているんです。体全体が恐ろしい武器なんです。なんですって?私たちの肉体は滅んでも、二人の魂は永遠に生き続けるでしょう。ジュリア、さあ、おお、ジュリア。 Julia.
ガッチャマンたちは2人の尊い命を、美しい愛情を救うことはできなかった。2人の愛をこの世に実らせることができる本当の平和が来るのはいつの日なのだろうか。
ロミナージュリア
Okay, so just to pause real quick and draw your attention to a couple of things, which you have probably noticed. First of all, Romeo and Julia. It's Romeo and Juliet. You know, they can't be together, star-crossed lovers. But they are dead. By the end of this scene, they are so very dead, and they are dead tragically. They could not, you know, they were turned into cyborgs. They could not return to human bodies. And not only that, but they are...missiles, right? They're going to explode. They're going to take things with them. They are dead and they are dangerous. So with that in mind, this is how it was changed in Battle of the Planets.
Diane, Orin, are you all right?
Mark, keep your distance.
You can't help us now.I don't know how to explain what's happened, but we're not what you expected to find. We've been changed.
Go away, Mark, and let us handle this the best way we can.
What's happened?
No, Mark, stay back.
Whatever Zoltar did to you, it's over now. The nightmare's over. You can go home.
That's not possible. Not the way we are now. Our spirits are here, but our bodies are back in the laboratory, Mark.I know that's hard to believe, but what you see before you is an illusion. You're looking at two humanoids that Zoltar created in our image.
No. I don't believe it.
I don't know if we can be like we were before. The transference may be irreversible, but we have to try.
It's very dangerous for us, and we may not survive. But it's our only chance.
Are you sure?
We don't have much time left, Mark. We have to do it now or never. Ready? Come. Diane?
And then they vanished. Where did they go? I'm not programmed to understand human emotions, but something deep down in my vertical integrator tells me that Diane and Orin are still together. Zoltar may have transformed their bodies into metal, but their spirits will always be united. Love is something so strong, it defeats evil every time. Diane and Orin were star-crossed lovers.And love is the ultimate power in all the universe. Could that comet be the vehicle carrying them to a paradise in the far reaches of space where their love can live on in some new and different form? Human love is such a beautiful and mysterious thing. But I think I know how Orin and Diane felt. There are times when I get this strong, urgent need in my capacitators for something. And I'm sure it's love.Of course, I'm very fond of you, One Rover One, but I was thinking of something just a little different.
Hello, Zark. This is Susan at the early warning station out on planet Pluto.
That's what I was thinking of. Hi, Susan.
I knew you would want me to fill you in on the latest developments concerning Diane and Auron.
Oh, I certainly do, Susan.
My infraprobe scanners monitored the flight of that comet, and it was actually carrying Diane and Auron.
Wonderful!
They went through time warp and entered a totally unknown and unexplored zone far beyond our galaxy.
Thank you, Susan. You've made my day.
You always make my day, Zark. Bye.
What a lovely voice, and such a warm personality. I wish I could meet her sometime. Oh, my. I wonder if she's too tall for me. You're right, Wanrover One. If she is too tall, my legs can be extended, or hers can be shortened. It's no big problem to create a perfect match for robots.
So, you can see where the differences lie. If they were very dead at the end of the last clip, at the end of this one, no, they're alive. Not only are they alive, they are off in another place exploring, I don't even know what. People didn't die in this version. And there was a lot of exposition to get us to that point, a lot of moralizing in some ways, you know, isn't love wonderful and all of this, you know, yeah, that's not why we're watching the show, you know. One of the things that people really loved about anime as it began to trickle into the United States in the 1970s and 1980s is that stuff happened. But as early as this, before home video was a contender in our sort of media landscape, this is what we got, nothing else. Sorry. And of course, you know, they're borrowing liberally from what was already popular. It was such a clear ripoff. The next anime in the 1980s that really took off in terms of popularity in the United States was Robotech, which was basically edited into an 85 episode saga put together from three completely separate anime, Macross, Super Dimension Cavalry, Southern Cross, and Genesis Climber Mosspeeda. All of these were basically left more or less intact so that things actually did happen. It was serialized, and there was kind of a loose bridge connecting each of them narratively. But again, this is before home video, and we don't really have what we recognize as anime fandom until after the introduction and popularity of home video. Why? Well, for one thing, prior to home video, and if you're my age, this will be old hat. If you are not, it may be news to you. We watched what was put on TV. That was it. And we watched it at the same time as everybody else. So, for example, here is an advertisement from the 1970s of Saturday morning cartoons. Cartoons came on Saturday morning. Reruns of cartoons came on in the afternoon. You watched them when they were broadcast. There was no rewinding. There was no I'll watch it later or record it. You watched television when it was on, and that was it. And you watched what you got, because that was all you had access to. So it took home video to really change not just what anime we got a hold of, but how we interacted with it and how we began to form fan communities. After home video, we had the release of licensed anime from Japan with either subtitles or dubbing. This was quite popular. And not only licensed anime, but also unlicensed anime video releases. And these tended to be either bootleg, where you connected two VHS or videotape machines together and pre-recorded one to a blank tape. The quality was terrible because VHS does not preserve quality particularly well. And of course, the more you watch, the same videotape, the more it degrades. So this is, I mean, it wasn't ideal, but it was the first time ever that people could watch things again. You know, I missed that scene. I really like that scene. I want to watch it again and again and again. That was me. Or, you know, I want to get a hold of this thing that nobody is showing on television here, which is the majority of the videos on the left-hand side of the screen. Things like Oh My Goddess, Ranma and a Half, those were never aired on air on television. They were aired, or they were obtained or seen on video. And it was this access to more Japanese animation than American broadcasters were giving us that led to things like anime-related fan magazines. This is just a couple. There were zine magazines that were put out by individual groups of fans. There were anime magazines that were sponsored by the official licensors of videos. And it was in these magazines that we really see the birth and sort of growth of what we would recognize today as anime fandom. For example, in these magazines, you can find advertisements for other videos. You can get entire series. This one, you know, says it's got an animation fan club, which would usually be mail order. And it would mostly entail a catalog that you could order from. There were also smaller scale places that were doing both in-store retail and mail order. Places like this one, Image Trading Company. They got the garage kits that became popularized through the guys behind Bandai. Gainax. We have the largest anime, you know, store in Texas here. Both of these do mail order and shipping. This is before the internet, of course, and so we couldn't go online and just pick out what we wanted. It really was what they had available and what we were willing to pay for. As well, magazines like this oftentimes had a video release schedule. So this is what you can look forward to. This is who's distributing it, whether it has subtitles, whether it's dubbed, whether it's only in Japanese, which was sometimes the case. But they also had what was coming soon in Japan, which is really interesting from the perspective of fandom outside of just the United States. And we talk about anime fandom in America, but it was during this period that we began to sort of be unable to kind of contain fandoms by geography. Because with information comes knowledge about different places, at the very least knowledge about what they're going to be able to see before we get to see it. And so you had all of this information about what was coming in from, or what was coming out in Japan. We had fan art, letters to the editor. So people are starting to give back to anime to sort of express their fandom. You know, and again, today, this is basically the analog version of things like DeviantArt, Twitter, Tumblr, things like that. And the letters to the editor were especially interesting in this sense, because this is really when we see fans not just taking what we're given, which was sort of the norm in the analog TV era before videotape, but they're also starting to talk back. In this particular example, there was an interview in this magazine in which somebody said that they would be trying to mainstream anime, and there was a huge outcry, so much so that the editor herself responded, basically saying, oh yeah, we got a lot of email, or we got a lot of letters about this. And debate is also going on rec.arts.animenewsgroup, which is our first sort of sighting of the internet starting to be a thing. And we already get a sense that that discussion is probably raging online, such as online is at the time. And so this is how a fandom sort of coalesces. This is how a fan community emerges. It's not just with watching and liking something, although that is, you know, the sort of baseline criteria for fandom, but it's starting to engage. It's sort of reaching past what is official to get at what I know is there, but, you know, is unofficial, things like that. Which brings us to what I talk about as the digital fandom contact zone. So contact zones are a thing that were theorized by Mary Louise Pratt in 1991. And she described a contact zone as, quote, a social space where people meet, clash, and grapple with each other, often in contexts of highly asymmetrical relations of power. So what does that mean in a sort of fandom context? And here I'm kind of going wide with fandom, but I mean, it very much fits within this sort of concept. Let's say we have fans from three different places, the United Kingdom, US, and South Korea, and we're all accessing the same media on very different platforms. That would be the background there. And we all sort of participated or sort of engage with it in different ways. So if you can see my cursor here, the arrow, you know, some people will watch something, access it on TV. Some people will, you know, this is a Pokemon thing, you know, they might be playing digitally, they might be into sports or into music. They might watch it on a laptop. They might cosplay, they might go to the theater, they might go to concerts or airports or something. For each group, you have that group's different ways of engaging with media, of watching media, and so forth. So let's say that all these people really are into Thor Ragnarok because they are like me, and I am also really into Thor Ragnarok because that was a great movie. For some people, they will have seen it in the movie theater. Actually, everybody here saw it in the movie theater. Some will engage with it, you know, through Star fandom. Apparently I did this not quite the way I expected. Some will talk about it on the internet. They're all doing that from, I'm like gesturing at my computer like you can see me. They're all doing that from their own context. So whatever is normal theater going, whatever is normal celebrity engagement, whatever is normal online discourse in the United States is happening here. Same with South Korea, same with the UK. They may not be the same in each different country. And that's where we sort of bump into this idea of the contact zone. We're all kind of doing things a little bit differently. So why does it matter? As I said at the beginning, this is, you know, in some ways kind of a presentation on how did we get here. And by here, I mean specifically, how did we get to the point where, you know, people go online from all over the world and just argue and argue and argue. A lot of it has to do with this contact zone. This is, I think, sort of a representation of, the media world as we live in it today. Again, we may be watching the same things, but we're watching them on vastly different platforms sometimes. We're communicating about them on, we may all be online, but it doesn't therefore stand to reason that we're all on the same online. We may not all be using the same social media. In East Asia, for example, Line is very popular. Here, it's unheard of. In other countries, it's other social media. And even when we have something like Twitter, Twitter is understood differently depending on the country that you're in. So for example, in the United States, you know, if I want to quote somebody's tweet, it's not that weird. If I want to retweet it, it's open and I retweet it, usually that's okay. In Japan, it's kind of a no-no to retweet if you haven't gotten permission. I think less so now, but there's still kind of a sense in Japan for example, that because most people don't read Japanese, they can't see our tweets, ergo, why would you want to retweet it? So don't retweet it. And so we're all engaging with the same things, but in vastly different ways. And this can lead to conflict. So I want to give you an example of this kind of conflict, how it arises and why. And I'm using the example of a conflict because it involves somewhat adult themes. I'm leaving it, just we're going to call it Q. If you're familiar with the conflict, you'll figure out what I'm talking about. I'm happy to answer questions about it later. But for now, just assume that there was a thing, it was called Q, in a Japanese anime, which is represented by the artist in the middle here. This Japanese anime was broadcasted globally on Crunchyroll. It was also broadcast in China on Youku, but I'm leaving that out for now because that's a whole other kettle. And in Japan, it was broadcast in the overnight hours on TV Asahi. The creator of it was actually involved to a certain extent in this controversy. And so I've put her self-portrait here in the middle. And this Japanese fans, overseas fans, Western fans, this is how she was conceptualizing responses she got to a certain point in the anime that people had vastly different takes on. So I'm going to switch it here to language groups, because I think more than Japanese fans, and more than Western or overseas fans, it's really language groups that were relevant here. Because not all the people who were, for example, tweeting to her in Japanese were Japanese nationals. Some were Korean, some were Western. And by the same token, not everybody who was commenting on this scene in a different direction was doing it in their own native language. Most of the sort of critical comments about what had happened in this anime were written in English. And it wasn't just, you know, quote unquote, Western fans. We had people from a number of different countries, again, where English was not the native language, but it was understood, at least to a certain extent, participating. And as people were participating in this sort of debate, going through the creator herself, she was getting sort of more and more heated about it, trying to say, look, this is what I intended with it, which is always going to get you in trouble. But the discourse sort of grew and grew. And to the extent that if you actually went off of Twitter, which she did not, if you went off of Twitter, you found that the Q is for people who were being critical of what they thought was going on in this episode. It turned out that people were also blogging about it in Japanese. They simply weren't tweeting her about it in Japanese. And so what she was seeing was a very small slice of a very big pie that was entirely characterized by this contact zone. So the contact zone is essentially a site, virtual, usually. It tends to be virtual more than in person, tends to be digital, and it's produced by a digital environment where we are in very close communication, even if we don't live close to each other. But each one of us brings our own cultural baggage, our own cultural familiarity, repertoires, if you will, to bear on the conversation. And so in the contact zone, and you can see this was Yuri on ice, we had, just in the context of this one debate, three different fanfiction, or three different cultures at play at the same time, each one kind of talking past the other. We had anime production culture, anime fan culture, and English language fanfiction culture. This is the symbol for AO3, or Archive of Our Own, which is where the fanfiction is, for a lot of it. And each one of these groups, each one of these cultures was bringing their own understanding of the situation to bear on what was going on. This is how we got where we are today. This is what we do on a regular basis throughout fandoms. It's not just anime fandom, but it is really characteristic of all fandom today, because we are all online, we are seeing things virtually simultaneously, but we're still seeing them from our own cultural contexts. And so when I teach about fandom, this is what I like to drive home to my students, that this more than anything is what's important to keep in mind when we kind of wade into online interactions within fandom cultures, within fandom contact zones, that we may not be seeing the same thing. I mean, even if we're seeing visually the same thing, we may not be understanding it in the same way. So that's what I wanted to talk about. And I would be happy to answer any questions that either this brings up, or if you have sort of related, or sky's the limit.
Yeah, we can wait a couple seconds to see if anyone has any questions. Thank you for that awesome presentation.
Thank you. It's okay if you don't, it's Saturday.
Okay, I don't know if anyone's gonna be asking any questions. I know there is like a little 10 second delay between like the video and showing on Facebook, but but otherwise, yeah, we can just end it if people can always come in if they have other questions and we can figure a way out later or something. But
and I'm on Twitter. I'm @acafanmom, acafanmom. So, you know, if you have a question or if you want to talk about any of this more, I'm more than happy to engage there.
Yeah, that sounds great. And I'll go ahead afterwards and just write that in as a comment from our Facebook page.
Sure.
If that's all good, then I think we're all set for the day. And thank you so much, Lori.
Thank you. I appreciate you having me.
Thanks.